Good afternoon, Cayman. You join us live for some breaking news. Following last night's election and the successful appointment of 19 new representatives, we can bring you today a statement from the Office of the Premier Designate. Mr. Wayne Panton writes, formation of new government following 2021 general elections. Early this morning, the 10 independent candidates elected following yesterday's general election met and agreed the following. Speaker of the House, Ulrich Lindsay. More on that appointment later because Mr. Lindsay wasn't successful in his seat. Premier Wayne Panton, Deputy Premier Chris Saunders. Premier designate Wayne Panton officially met with the Governor this morning to formally request that the Parliament be convened on Wednesday, 21st of April at 10 a.m. to swear in members and formally elect the Premier under Section 49(3) of the Cayman Islands Constitution. Premier designate Wayne Panton is quoted as saying, "The elections are over, the people have spoken, and it is time to get on with the business of making people's lives better. I am delighted, impressed, and inspired by the level of maturity shown by the elected independent members to put aside political differences that arose on the campaign and work in the best interests of our islands. All of us who decided to step into the public arena did so to make a positive difference to the communities we serve. Many good people were unsuccessful at the polls, but still have a lot to offer. Ulrich Lindsay is one such individual. As Speaker of the House, he will bring the much-needed articulation and maturity to the role. The government that I am humbled to lead will be people-driven, accountable, competent and transparent, PACT. We are all humbled by the electorate's trust and recognise that we have much work to do and we are ready and willing to work on your behalf." It goes on, "I am tremendously proud that the 10 independent candidates have joined together in a decisive and cohesive fashion to commence the process of forming a new government. Although PACT has the majority and are committed to that as a government, we will demonstrate to the country a refreshing and new approach by being open to other elected members in order to carry out the wishes of the electorate to form an inclusive coalition to work in the best overall interests of the country." I'm joined by Editor-in-Chief Kevin Morales. Kevin, let's have a look at who those independent candidates are that he refers to in his statement. First of all, Mr. Panton, the Premier Designate, as the statement comes from the Office of the Premier Designate, as I mentioned, successful in Newlands last night. He looks set to be the new Premier.
Yeah, you know, it's got to be a pretty wild last 24 hours for Mr. Panton. Entering the election, you know, if I'm one of the members of his campaign team, I'm feeling confident, but I'm not thinking that a win is in the bag necessarily, especially, you know, we heard over and over again Mr. Roy Bodden last night providing some analysis saying, you know, simply by being the incumbent, you have the advantage. And then when we're talking about having a snap election, that probably enhances that advantage even more because you already, you know, you've hit the ground running, whereas other candidates, including Mr. Panton, are reeling a little bit. And so, you know, if you're part of Mr. Panton's campaign, not only are you elated that you've won the race, but now, less than 24 hours later, have been able to bring 10 independent candidates together and form a government. And we should, and as you pointed out, Caroline, we should mention that this is coming from the Office of the Premier Designate. This is not from the governor's office. This is not from Government Information Services or anything like that. But that being said, this is the rumor that we've been hearing all day. For hours now, our team has been tracking down members, independent members, saying, "Hey, is this true?" Trying to find out where people are meeting. We understand that members of the Progressives Party are actually meeting, have been meeting this afternoon together to see if they would still be able to form a government. So this is the rumor that we've been hearing all day, literally from this morning when I first walked in. Our publisher Kathleen Capetta, "Hey, come here. Did you hear this? And is this true?" And as we're finding out now, they're making the official announcement. Mr. Panton is our next premier of the Cayman Islands.
Yeah, I think, Kevin, I was just going to remind everyone how Mr. Panton did in his seat last night. He won 55.23% of the vote in Newlands, and he unseated the incumbent, Alva Sekou, there, who had run alongside the Progressives in this campaign, who only achieved 29.1% of the vote. So a fairly significant win for Mr. Panton in his constituency, perhaps something that buoyed him when he went into those talks with these other independent members last night. The next name on the list, shall we take a look? We've got Chris Saunders, the MP-elect for Boddon Town West.
We got a big Chris Saunders there. Let me come out of that. So Chris Saunders, you know, not as much, not necessarily kind of the suspense with his race last night as we would have had, you know, with some other candidates and Mr. Saunders being able to come in relatively, you know, easily. But again, we have Mr. Saunders here who, you know, a lot of people, I would say most people, consider him to be a very bright young politician. We've seen him sit on the opposition bench, and now is his time to, you know, bring some of those ideas that he has and some of those motions that he either has brought in the past or perhaps wanted to bring, but knew that they probably would not be successful. And now is his time to come in and. They potentially can be successful here.
And Mr. Saunders last night polling 79.61% of the vote against 20.39 for Vincent Frederick, who was running again on that Progressives Alliance platform. Quite a decisive result for Mr. Saunders. As we said, you know, perhaps one of the easier races to call earlier in the evening. Actually, incidentally, both Chris Saunders and Wayne Panton were included before the election. Our issues editor, James Whittaker, calling those names out when you're listening to independent candidates running. Both those two gentlemen had been tipped as possible linchpins, you know, about whom a possible coalition could be formed.
Right.
So not perhaps surprising to see those two names on the list here. The next name, we have J.E. Banks, that's right.
Apologies, all the photos that I just pulled in here so I could make them big and do all the cool animation have disappeared on me, so apologies as I bring them in here.
While you're doing that, Kevin, I'll just reiterate how Mr. Ebanks did in last night's vote. He unseated the incumbent, Ezard Miller, in Northside. Mr. Ebanks with 54.87% of the vote to Mr. Miller's 30.22%. So quite a scalping there last night for the Northside MP-elect, Jay Ebanks. He's also listed amongst the 10 independent candidates that we believe are going to form the next government.
All right.
The next name on the list. Should we go to Mr. Lindsay?
Yeah, we got him here.
Now, he's an interesting one. I think most people will be wondering, how can you be a speaker designate if you haven't won your seat?
Right.
Because, of course, Mr. Lindsay last night lost in the Georgetown South race to Barbara Connolly. Kevin, can you explain a little bit about how that can happen? The speaker's an interesting role.
Right, it is. It can be somebody who has been elected as a legislator, as we would have seen over the last 4 years with West Bay West lawmaker Mr. Minkiva Bush. But it doesn't have to be. And honestly, it just depends on the government and probably what is most advantageous for them as to whether they're going to bring in somebody from the outside. I would assume Mr. Lindsay has been a part of the discussions behind closed doors probably for weeks, if not months now, forming, you know, partnerships and you know, alliance is the big buzzword that's being used this campaign season, forming alliances probably with Mr. Panton and several other of the independent candidates ahead of time, should he have been successful. And now that he was not, they want to stay loyal to people. And it also, in one way or another, might be advantageous for them in terms of forming a government to have him as the speaker. And there could be a variety of reasons for that. We could sit here for days and guess as to why that might be. But obviously somebody felt that it was important to have the legislators sit in the government bench, and Mr. Lindsay would then take on the role as speaker.
So just going back to the reference to Mr. Lindsay in that statement from Mr. Panton, he said many good people were unsuccessful at the polls but still have a lot to offer, and named Alric Lindsay as one such individual. And interestingly, in the following sentence he says he will bring the much needed articulation and maturity to the role of speaker. I wonder if we could read into that perhaps a little barb at Minkiva Bush.
Yeah, I certainly think we could probably read into that one. And again, there's probably a variety of reasons why they decided to have him be speaker, and maybe that is just one of them. You know, maybe they said something about this person's character. We think that they would make, you know, a good speaker. Who knows? Like I said, we could sit here forever and take guesses as to why that decision was made. At the end of the day, like I said, it probably has a lot to do with the fact that they had made plans and mm-hmm. felt that he would be loyal to the team, if you want to call it that, had he been successful. And now that he hasn't been, they still want to keep him involved. And to be honest with you, we've heard that from candidates throughout the debate season who have said, even about their opponents. You know, I remember Ms. Turner, who's also going to form a part of this government, Ms. Sabrina Turner, who had won in Prospect last night. I was the moderator for the Prospect crosstalk debate when it was Michael Miles and Sabrina Turner in for that specific debate. And on the way out, Ms. Turner and I were talking, and you know, she's like, I've got a relationship with Michael, and Michael and I work well together. And should I be successful, you know, I will call on him for assistance. And she would have expected the same thing from him. Mm-hmm. So, those are opponents, you know.
Exactly.
So I think that people recognize other people with shared values, shared goals, and they want to be able to call on them, even mm-hmm. if it's an opponent. They mm-hmm. want to be able to call on them for their insight and expertise and mm-hmm. opinion. And that very well might have been the case with Mr. Lindsay here.
Before we go on to the next
sure.
candidate, Kevin, I'm just going to interrupt you. We can now confirm we have had an official release coming out of Government Information Services. The release reads as follows. Elected candidate Mr. Wayne Panton meets the governor. Newly elected candidate from the Newlands Electoral District, Mr. Wayne Panton, met with His Excellency the Governor, Mr. Martin Roper, at the Governor's office today, Thursday, 15th of April, 2021. Mr. Panton presented to the Governor his letter confirming that he has the support of the majority of the elected candidates who were successful in yesterday's general election to Parliament, and that he intends to form the new government. So, Justin, a little bit of breaking news there coming straight from the Government Information Services office, that confirming that Mr. Panton has met with the Governor and that he does very well intend to form the new government. And that tallies with what Mr. Panton said in his statement, that he has formally requested Parliament to be called on Wednesday, 21st of April, next week, 10 a.m., to swear in members and formally elect the Premier.
All right. So, sorry, I'm still in the middle of my dragging in photos
here. That was a convenient little break, wasn't it, for you to get
your... It was, and I'm missing one person. Who am I missing? Sabrina Turner.
Sabrina Turner.
Yes, I am. I don't want to forget about Ms. Turner, so let me bring her in here. The other thing that we heard a lot throughout the day, it's so funny, even when these things are rumors, how specific the information can be. And throughout the day today, we had heard not only who would make up the government, we were hearing information, even as detailed as what ministries they would take up. And obviously, all of that is still to be worked out, I'm sure. But so far, the information that we've been hearing all day and that, you know, others have been talking about all day, some of it's adding up right now. Mm-hmm. So you never know. That all might end up being true, what we have been hearing. So so we have Chris Saunders here that we've covered, Mr. Ulrich Lindsay. This is somebody that I think we need to talk about as well, Jay Ebanks, who was so close to winning in 2017. And this year, was able to unseat Ezard Miller, the longtime mm-hmm. politician in Northside. Here we go from a gentleman who knew he was going to have a tough race. I don't know if it's fair to say he was the underdog. I think a lot of people felt that he would, you know, be able to be right there with Mr. Miller, and in the end, he ended up taking that seat. But in the last, in less than 24 hours, you go from being elected to now being able to form a government. And again, we've heard just kind of behind the scenes and unofficially who might be receiving what ministries or mm-hmm. who might be a counselor. So certainly an exciting time for Mr. Jay Ebanks as well, who is tapped to be one of our new 10 government members.
The next name on the list is Kenneth Bryan, Georgetown Central.
Here we go. There he is.
Now, Mr. Bryan, perhaps, again, another seat that wasn't too much a surprise when we saw the results come in. Mr. Bryan, very popular sitting MP. He polled 87.1% of the vote, one of the very highest numbers of the night. He lost to Frank Cornwall, the Progressives member, who polled just 12.9%. Now, Mr. Bryan's been sitting on the opposition benches for the last 4 years. This is his moment, Kevin, to have a cabinet position, potentially.
And that's all. That's all Kenneth has wanted for such a long time, right? You have to remember that Kenneth kind of got his first political experience under the tutelage of the outgoing premier, Mr. Alden McLaughlin, and with the Progressives, and he was a member of the Progressives. And then there was a split, and in 2017, he was able to, and I think it's fair to say, upset the incumbent Marco Archer in Georgetown Central. But that has always been Mr. Bryant's complaint, is that, you know, he feels that he has good ideas for the people of Georgetown Central. He has brought private members' motions to the floor, but he hasn't been able to be successful just because it is so difficult as an opposition member to get something passed by the government, right? Especially if it's something that's controversial or maybe not universally accepted as something that Cayman needs. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But yeah, I think Mr. Bryant is probably a happy man today, knowing that not only did he get reelected, but that he would also be in a position where he can take some of those ideas and potentially turn them into reality in terms of new legislation, regulations, whatever.
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Bryant, you're saying potentially a happy man today. We certainly saw that last night in the celebration footage from outside Constitution Hall. Mr. Bryant flanked by his supporters. He was wearing a crown. He was delighted.
He was wearing a crown, wasn't he?
He was pretty enthusiastic in that footage.
Where did you get that?
You can see all of that. It looked like a Burger King
crown. I think he went to Burger King. I was actually going to say that, yeah.
You can see all of those celebration footage. That's all on the Cayman Compass homepage. We have plenty of footage from last night if you want to relive some of those exciting moments and see reaction from these 10 members who would be the next government. The next name on the list we have on going off this list, we have Isaac Rankin.
There he is
in the top. Mr. Rankin, again, last night, Kevin, he unseated the incumbent as a veteran lawmaker in the form of Arden McLean.
Yes, and very similar to his new fellow government member from Northside, you know, Isaac Rankin was very close in 2017 to winning that seat from the incumbent, Arden McLean. And, you know, it was interesting going into this race. Just I can speak for me personally. I wasn't quite sure what to make of this race again, the East End seat, I should say, because it was close. So I think we all anticipated that Mr. Rankin would be able to give Mr. McLean a run for his money. Mm-hmm. But also Mr. McLean had become, you know, very active recently, taking over as leader of the opposition during the last 4 years. And then also kind of formalizing the opposition and really being an outspoken member of the opposition, especially around December with the conviction of Makeeva Bush. And he was one of those people who was calling on the government to remove Mr. Bush as speaker and had been highly, highly critical of the government for calling the early elections in an attempt to remove Mr. Bush from his seat. And Mr. McLean, you know, wasn't satisfied with that. Mm-hmm. So because of that, because he had been so vocal and so visible as of late, you know, you weren't quite sure if that would kind of tip the scales in his favor. But Mr. Rankin, again, able to win that seat and less than 24 hours later.
Before we leave him, I was going to say an interesting character, because we saw very early in the election campaign, on the campaign trail, quite publicly, the outgoing premier was spotted, his car, his official car, was spotted at one of Mr. Rankin's campaign events. It sparked all sorts of rumors that perhaps Mr. Rankin was joining the Progressives. He had to issue a statement saying he was running very much as an independent candidate, but his point was very much, it has not served the people of East End to have had their elected representative be on the opposition benches for such a long period of time, and therefore he wasn't ruling anything out. If he was successful, he very much intended to have a cabinet or to have a government position.
So you and I were in this very room less than 24 hours ago, and all of us were talking about the very real possibility that even though the Progressives couldn't form a government just on their elected members, and with the election of independent member Dwayne Seymour from Bodentown East, who had been a part of the unity government, I think the general consensus is two phone calls from Mr. McTaggart or Mr. McLaughlin to Isaac Rankin, to Andre Ebanks, and they would be able to form a government. And we left here last night thinking that that was going to be the easiest path forward for forming a government, partly because of those rumors that were sparked, A, by, you know, the parked cars, but, you know, there had been mentions, calls by name at certain political rallies, etc. So, you know, we were thinking, just based on that evidence, that, oh, the seven Progressives are going to have Mr. Seymour, that's eight. They'll make two phone calls, and we'll have
10.
Our government.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have a government, and it does involve these two. It does not involve the Progressives or Mr. Bush or Mr. Seymour. Mm-hmm. So it's just very interesting how in you know, what, like 18 hours or so, we have gone from, this is how it's going to be, and involving these two, they're going to be very key members of that setup, of that government, And now they're going to be very key members of this actual government.
Mm-hmm. And last night, of course, as we waited for that last result to come in for Georgetown South, and we saw the election of Barbara Connolly holding on to her seat there.
Of course.
The mood was very much that was it, that the Progressives, in securing Ms. Connolly's seat, they'd done it. They had the momentum going into these sort of negotiations. So, you know, buoyant celebrations from the Progressives last night, I think, very much the mood of confidence going into negotiations,
right.
and what a 180 degree turn we've seen today.
Absolutely, and here's another person who this was always going to be a very interesting race from the get-go. Again, we talked at length yesterday about the dynamic with these two having been members of the same party, mm-hmm. and now not so much. And that party doesn't even exist anymore. But Bernie Bush, again, to me, for Mr. Bush, if I'm Mr. Bush today, or you know somebody who's affiliated with him or his campaign, this confirms that he made the right move by leaving the government and by distancing himself from Mikiva Bush. And, mm-hmm. and if you really look at it, the people that were not quick to distance themselves from Mr. Bush, and in fact, the people who had kind of aligned themselves with him during this campaign, Mr. Rolston, Captain Eugene Ebanks in West Bay Central, they both lost. Mm. And here you have Mr. Bush, who, you know, won by 10 percentage points. It's not a landslide, but it's certainly not a nail biter like some of the other races that we had seen. So I'm feeling very good about if I'm Mr. Bush, I'm feeling very good about my decision to leave, be outspoken on certain issues. You know, I saw all over social media during the campaign trail his whole thing about not for sale, not for rent. Mm-hmm. People remembered that. People appreciated him, standing up for, you know, environmental rights or whatever you want to say about it. So I'm feeling pretty good that I made the right decision today if I'm Mr. Bush.
The next name on the list, we had Catherine Ebanks Wilkes, West Bay Central.
Yes, we do.
Look at those results.
And same thing. And this was a very close race in 2017 as well. And not only did she pick up the win, partly because, you know, she was campaigning on the fact that Mr. Ebanks has for years, a long time, aligned himself with Mr. Bush. Mm-hmm. You know, we heard lots of calls for change. And when you have a politician that has been in a particular seat for so long, I think that maybe hits home with voters a little bit more than if it were somebody who had just served one term and you're calling for change. And obviously the people of West Bay Central, they heard that and that made an impact with them. So Ms. Ebanks, again, one of those who went from, you know, 2 days ago, we know this is going to be a tight race, to same week, not only did she win, she's formed part of the government.
Absolutely. And she's one of a number of women tipped amongst those 10 successful candidates. A couple of the others, we had Sabrina Turner in, who is the MP-elect for Prospect. There she is. Now this one, talk about a tight race split between three candidates. There's not that much difference from Mr. Harris in third place, 210 votes, to Ms. Turner, 235 there, enough to secure that seat, and she's tipped as a member of this, or she's named as a member of this current government.
All right, and last but not least, we have the electoral district of Savannah, Heather Bodden. You know, another legislator who had been a progressive member and had aligned herself with the progressives for a long time. She was one of three, including Osborne Bodden in Bodentown East and Mr. Panton in Newlands, mm-hmm. who had been progressives members, served as legislators as progressives, and who had not only left the progressives, but then decided to, you know, form their own kind of alliance. Mm-hmm. And so that was interesting in and of itself. And again, they have to be feeling like they did the right thing here. You know, and it's really interesting. We were talking about the party system last night quite a bit, and we know Roy Bodden's opinions about the party system and why it's necessary. And, you know, we've heard Alden McLaughlin throughout the campaign talk about this idea that independent members are going to be able to rally themselves together and form a government is nonsensical. And look what happened in 2017. That's proof that we need the party system and that voting for independents willy-nilly just isn't a good idea. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's really interesting to me about this entire thing is, you know, not necessarily that the people that got in to form part of the government, because we figured some of these members would become government members anyway, mm-hmm. Just because they're bright or what have you. But the fact that in less than 24 hours, they were able to get all 10 independents who had not previously served with the government to come together to agree to form the government, it really kind of blows my mind, especially when, you know, when you put it against the backdrop of the 2017 elections, where it took a week and a half to finally have a confirmed government, mm-hmm. and we had had rumors put out there about independents coming together. Everybody remembers the photo with McKeever Bush and all the independent members looking very sad at that time.
Yeah, Mr. Miller didn't look happy at all.
And Mr. McLean didn't look happy at all to be taking that photo. Obviously, the photographer didn't say cheese. Mm-hmm. And that took so long, and it was a really agonizing time for the country and for voters, and to some degree, probably a time of you're just not feeling stable, mm-hmm. you know, because mm-hmm. you don't have a government mm-hmm. formed. And we were able to avoid that altogether here. And they were able to do it with such speed, and they were so nimble that you have to think, and I think we do actually have some information coming in, that if they hadn't been talking about this for, you know, the weeks leading up to the campaign, to the election, certainly they were on the phone all night last night saying, hey, before anybody else calls you, let's hash this out. Let's make this work. Let's not let this turn into another 2017. There's a lot of people in Cayman who support independent candidates because they see what's wrong with the party system, or what they perceive to be wrong mm-hmm. with the party system. And so for those people out there, I mean, they're breathing a sigh of relief tonight, because at least for the time being, and we can get into what will happen 6 months down the line, a year down the line, at least for the time being, this is the first time that we're seeing the one man, one vote system where this many independents have been voted in and have actually been able to form a government, mm-hmm. and did it so quickly.
So quickly. And we have had a little bit more information coming into us, Kevin, from Government Information Services. That statement has been reissued, and this time two photos accompany the release, and it shows Mr. Panton shaking hands with the governor, delivering his letter. We'll post, obviously, both of those photos will be on the Cayman Compass homepage and our Facebook page. His Excellency the Governor, Mr. Martin Roper, meets with Newlands elected candidate Mr. Wayne Panton, who called on him today. Pictured in the photo, Attorney General Honourable Samuel Bolgen, Mr. Panton, the Deputy Governor Franz Manderson, and the Governor. And a second picture of Mr. Panton presenting that letter that we mentioned earlier to the Governor, expressing his intent to form the next government.
Come on in, Iris. Come on in.
Here we go, and that's that statement. This is the magic of breaking news. We have that statement being delivered to Kevin now as we speak.
Yeah, thank you very much, Iris, for bringing this up.
Well, we stuck with Prospect. It wasn't Prospect. It was
Newlands.
It wasn't Newlands. It was Heather Bodden.
Savannah.
Thank you, Kevin. It's been a long few hours for us here at the Compass. Some of the best celebrations.
Not much sleep, no.
Who can sleep when excitement's happening?
Exactly.
Ms. Bodden last night, among one of the candidates celebrating the hardest, our reporter at Seaford Russell was with her, and there were tears, there were cheers. It's a lovely piece of video reaction, and that's
yes.
of course all on our Cayman Compass homepage.
Yes, it is. So it is official now. Like I said, it's so interesting the way that the news cycle works in a small community, where for hours we had been hearing this, but we weren't comfortable reporting it because we could not confirm it. And the last thing we want to do is report something that turns out to be false, and we have egg on our face, and also it can be detrimental to, if it hadn't actually been formed, it would be detrimental to that process, right?
Absolutely.
And we don't want to be part of the news. We just want to report the news, right? That's our job. So that was hours ago. That was this morning, and our reporters have been reaching out. I would even go as far as saying harassing the elected members today, calling, WhatsApping, you know, text messages. Where are you? Where can we meet up with you? We're hearing this. Are we able to confirm it? And it was radio silence for much of the day as these negotiations were continuing. But at the end of the day, here we go.
And we did hear at one stage, Kevin, we thought that perhaps one member had withdrawn, they'd signed up, and then they'd, you know, withdrawn their support at the last minute. So
right.
That's why, you know, we were just waiting for those final confirmations to be made.
Well,
I just wanted quickly, we touched on Mr. Ebanks in relation to Mr. Rankin perhaps being touted as two candidates that the Progressives Alliance would reach out to form their government with. I just wanted to spend a little bit more time on Mr. Ebanks, because I think people feel very strongly because of his role in the civil service. He was deputy chief officer in the Ministry of Community Affairs, which of course falls under the remit of the outgoing premier. So I think, in hindsight, perhaps Mr. Ebanks keeping mum on any formal sort of alliance or loyalty or desire to work with the progressives, perhaps we should have read more into that silence, because we see obviously today he's listed amongst the other members, and no doubt he came at a high price. I'm sure we're about to see a fairly significant cabinet position for him.
So two things of note that our political analysts had provided to us yesterday. So I remember Richard Barton at one point specifically bringing up the fact that we should not automatically say that Duane Seymour in Bodentown East will be a member of the next government, even though he was a member of the unity government, because he went out of his way to keep that independent title. And the same thing with Austin Harris. And who knows, had Mr. Harris been elected, all I know is this. Mr. Ebanks was one of those people who very easily could have said, I'll join the alliance, the Progressives Alliance. Mm-hmm. Or he could have decided, never mind this independent, I'll just join the progressives, right? But he didn't. I'm assuming that somebody in his campaign, or maybe Mr. Ebanks himself, understood that having that choice once elected is going to work in his favor. It gives him leverage.
It certainly is. He holds a lot of the cards, I think, today in those negotiations.
And you wonder, I would love to, been a fly on the wall when those calls were being made last night, because you have to assume that at some point during his campaigning, he had thought that, if the progressives are able to form a government with their alliance, do I want to be a part of that? And I think, we have to assume that was at least an option for him, given the position that he had, as you had mentioned. Something changed his mind last night. We don't know what it was. It could have been something that happened on the campaign trail with the progressives. Maybe he heard something he didn't like. Maybe there are members of that alliance that he did not want to align himself with. Mm-hmm. Or maybe he just truly believes that the independents could come together and he wanted to be a part of that. Whatever it was, he was one of those who everybody assumed, he's with the progressives. Mm-hmm. He's with the progressives. Mm-hmm. He'll be a part of that government if he gets elected. And it's simply not true. And he never came out and, explicitly said as much.
Exactly.
Because, now today he's able to form this, be a part of this government that's being formed, and nobody can accuse him of being a liar, or nobody can accuse him of being disingenuous. Mm-hmm. So, politically, it was a really smart move.
Very savvy campaign.
And he was able to, stay nimble and give himself those options.
I wonder how many of those 253 votes that he polled yesterday, I wonder how many of those people voted for him under the same assumptions misassumptions that we all made, that was a vote effectively for a progressives candidate.
And that was a debate that our panelists were having last night. And is it fair, put it this way, if a candidate doesn't come out and say, I want to be a part of this alliance, or I want to be a part of that team, can you blame them if they never said what their intentions were in terms of, uniting with other political parties? Can you turn around and blame them for not doing what you assumed they would do, right? At the end of the day, if somebody had made that assumption about Mr. Ebanks, that was their thought that they had formed. Mm-hmm. Again, because, and I'm not going to lie, I didn't go to all of, Mr. Ebanks' political rallies or anything like that, and I certainly did not hear every word that he would have said during the campaign trail. But as far as I'm aware, he has never explicitly said, yes, I want to be a member of the Progressives or the Progressives Alliance, or yes, if I'm elected, I will definitely form a government with the progressives and their alliance. Mm-hmm. As far as I'm aware, those words weren't said. So it's a little bit hard now to turn around and say, well, I voted for you because I thought you were going to do this. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, that was your thought.
I never said that,
right? Mm-hmm. And they were having the similar discussion about whether Mr. Seymour in Bodentown East should actually just be considered a progressives member because he was on their manifesto. Mm-hmm. And could the members of Bodentown East, the voters of Bodentown East, turn around and be upset if he did not want to form a government with them? And maybe that's a little bit of a different situation because he was on the manifesto. But Alden McLaughlin actually did come to his rallies and was, you know, very visible there.
That's right. So
maybe that's a slightly different scenario. But at the end of the day, like I said, there was a reason that independents, many of our independents, stayed independent and didn't want to align themselves with somebody. Meanwhile, and this is a bit off, you know, off on a tangent, you have somebody like Alva Sekou, who had been running as an independent, had been a member of the opposition, then distanced himself from the opposition, ran as an independent, but then, you know, later in the race, then became a member of the Progressives Alliance. And you wonder what that meant for him in terms of vote count.
Yes.
I'm not going to say that's why he lost his seat.
Yeah.
I don't know that. It makes you wonder, though.
It does. We saw last night, Kevin, we saw two casualties in the form of Mr. Miller losing his seat in Northside and Arden McLean, the leader of the opposition, in East End. Mm-hmm. I wonder if in some of these candidates, the independence candidates' thought process when they were signing up to this coalition of independent candidates, I wonder if they saw in these examples, you know, how it plays out at the polls when you've been in opposition for a long time, when you haven't been part of the government, you haven't been able to push your agendas and your you can't get the support you need to deal with local constituency issues.
You know, that's a risky idea for an independent candidate to run on.
Mm.
If you're a member of the government, it's easy. It's an easy platform to
you
have,
can
right?
Get stuff done.
I can get stuff done because I've been a member of that government. That longtime legislator is always on the other side, can never get anything done for you. But as an independent, you don't know that you're going to be able to become a part of the next government. And in fact, based on very recent history, I think it was embarrassing for those independents in 2017, some of whom were, you know, backed financially in a very significant way. I think it was embarrassing for them to not be able to make it happen. And it gave fodder for day. If you're the Progressives in 2017, you're laughing at what happened, right? It was an embarrassment. And now the tables have completely mm-hmm. turned. And it's absolutely fascinating to me. And what it means, you know, I don't know. It's all just a guess. But all I know is this. Somebody took the bull by the horns last night. And from what we're hearing, and this isn't official information, we're hearing it was Mr. Panton, was on the phone immediately calling the independent members, rallying them together, saying, guys, let's make this happen. If we are able to come together and we're all truly passionate about this change that we've been talking about and we're genuinely unhappy with the sitting government members, let's come together before they split us up, essentially. And what happened was they were able to unify in a very significant way before any of them were able to splinter off due to the horse trading that I'm sure was going on.
And we have a little bit more breaking news coming in, Kevin. These independent candidates today, we understand Panton and his colleagues were huddling this afternoon at the White House, formerly the DMS building in Georgetown, and everyone there just referring reporters to the statement that he has issued, that statement that we brought you earlier. No one sort of going off-piste and saying anything further at this stage, but very interesting developments coming to us this afternoon.
Yeah, so this is probably TMI. So I got a call from one of the members of the government. I won't give the TMI part. And it was a very quick conversation, and it was just, hey, we're going to send you a release. And I'm like, we haven't been able to get in touch with any of you all day. You're not getting off the phone that easily with me. Is this true? And a lot of it he wouldn't confirm. But the bit just about who would be making up the government, he would. However, I got the impression, and I should use the word impression because, again, this isn't anything official coming out of the government. He didn't confirm, you know, who would be responsible for what or anything like that. And so, you know, I'm sure there's still much that has to be worked out on that front. But, yes, obviously there were calls being made last night and there were meetings and huddles. Good to know about the location. We'll keep that on our radar for next election as a place to kind of stake out.
And we should say that our reporter, Andrew Harris, has been there. It is his reporting coming into us from that location. He's there gathering video and picture as we speak and trying to find someone who would be prepared to talk to him and let us in on a little bit more detail about the negotiations.
And that's what kind of got me thinking about the phone call I got. He wouldn't say anything else. And so they are, while they've confirmed now that they have a government, And now that the governor's office has confirmed that they have a government, you wonder how much is still to be worked out in terms of responsibilities, the various roles that they'll play, etc. I would assume that some of that has been kind of hammered out, or I don't think they would have been able to form this government.
I think you might be right.
So we'll have to see in the coming days, is, you know, in terms of who's responsible for what, taking on what ministries, etc. But
it is quite an extraordinary turn of events. I mean, I don't feel that we can sort of overlabor that point. It is not what we were expecting when we finished our program last night. It is not. We'd heard rumors, but none of us could really quite get our heads around it this morning. I'm quite shocked. It is really a remarkable turn of events.
It is. And again, partly because just the assumption last night, and that's all it was an assumption, but, you know, educated guesses, I would say, was that, again, they were two phone calls away from the progressives, I should say, were two phone calls away from being able to have, you know, establish a government. And coming in this morning and hearing that rumor, was just the last thing that I would have expected. I also, you know, the question was asked, how long is it going to take to form this government? And my guess was we would have gone into the weekend. But again, I think there was probably an urgency based on what happened in 2017 for them to make this happen. Sorry, I can't talk and figure out the alphabet at the same time. I've just realized that is a limitation that I have.
For?
Looking for Mr. Panton.
He's double, he's at the bottom.
I think I've got it backwards.
Oh, it's backwards.
It is backwards.
That's
all right, we'll sort that out. But yeah, you know, it went extremely quickly, and I don't think anybody could have called this. You know, we have Mr. Biden, who's a former legislator. We have Richard Barton, who just finds this stuff fascinating. We had Tammy Suleiman, who has been a longtime journalist, covered many elections, you know, has close personal contacts who are legislators. Kind of keeps her, you know, finger on the pulse of politics in Cayman, and I don't think she would have guessed it. So, you know, this is a complete surprise, but like I said, I think what happened was there's just a sense of urgency to make this happen so that they don't have egg on their face, you know, similar to what happened in 2017.
And I suppose the longer the negotiations go on, there's more chance that someone in the Progressives will approach one of these people and offer them something that they can't turn down. You know, as long as those negotiations are drawn out and remain in play, as it were, then there's always a chance that someone will be turned, as it were. We're seeing a little bit more news coming into us here at the Cayman Compass. The governor has spoken to our reporter Reshma Raghunath. She's been staked out outside the government administration building, and he says he will not be making any statements today. So nothing further expected from the governor. We have obviously seen the government information services issuing that statement today with the photographs of Mr. Panton submitting his letter to the governor.
So I just wanted to bring up these three members of the government in particular, just to kind of rehash what we do know in terms of leadership and what the roles will be. So we've got, that is not how that picture should look. We've got Mr. Panton here. Wayne Panton, the elected member from Newlands, is your new premier. We have Mr. Ulrich Lindsay here. Mr. Ulrich Lindsay, who actually lost his race in Georgetown South, will be the Speaker of the House. And I've accidentally picked up Jay Ebanks here, but it's actually Chris Saunders from Bodentown West, who will be serving as your Deputy Premier. Let me just bring in Chris if I can here.
And we'll just have another look at how those gentlemen performed in their respective seats last night. So Wayne Panton in Newlands, he polled 55.23% of the vote to his challenger, the incumbent Alva Sekou, 29.17%, Mr. Raul Gonzalez Jr. And Royal Carter also running in that seat. Bodentown West, Chris Saunders, the future Deputy Premier, he had a decisive victory in his seat. He held on to that with 79.61% of the vote. And Mr. Lindsay, of course, one that I think lots of people will be interested in today. He actually lost his seat to Barbara Connolly, the sitting MP, a member of the Progressives. He polled 47.28% to Ms. Connolly's 52.72%. But as Mr. Panton states in his in his message released earlier today that many unsuccessful members were still having, and in his words, have a lot to offer. So he has been, he's sort of Speaker of the House designate coming out of today's news.
And I wonder if that language was intentional as well. You know, one of the things that we've heard throughout this campaign has, you know, we're hearing lots and lots of calls to bring dignity back to the parliament, right? That's kind of the one thing, that, and I think we all know why, and that's probably revolves around one particular member. But, you know, that language is probably intentional because I think, you know, potentially Mr. Panton is showing that, you know, he wants to work with smart, forward-thinking individuals who are going to help him and his team and his government achieve the goals that they want to achieve, whether that person was elected or not. You know, I think probably what he's trying to say there, if I'm reading between the lines, is we just want to do what's best for the country, whether that is, you know, me or you or somebody who's not even sitting in this House but has a great idea that aligns with our goals, let's do it.
And that's, it's interesting, your reference to the word dignity there. In this statement, we see perhaps a little glimmer into what this next government, what their sort of, what their banner is going to be that's going to unite these 10 independent candidates. We're talking about a people-driven, capital P, accountable, capital A, competent, capital C, and transparent government, capital T, pact. And he refers to that again later on in the statement. So we're looking at people-driven, so putting forward the needs of the constituents first, accountable, competent, and transparent. Interesting words there, but perhaps a little hint at what we might see being the overarching theme for some of the policies that we might expect to come out of that government. Another interesting line that I want to get into in that statement. At the end, Mr. Panton says they are open to other elected members joining this alliance, this coalition, in order to carry out the wishes of the electorate to form an inclusive coalition to work in the best overall interests of the country. Now, I wonder if that's a call to some, and I'm thinking in particular of Mr. Seymour, who, of course, never officially joined the Progressives, although he ran very publicly alongside them. He's been publicly backed by them. We saw that particularly with the COVID-19 crisis. The Premier sat alongside him, Mr. Seymour very much a part of that response. I wonder if in that line that's an open call, that's a suggestion that the door is open. We've got the 10 we need, but we're willing to accept more.
I'm sure that it is. And I mean, wouldn't that be the smart thing to do? You know, one of the reasons that I think this was able to work in the first place is because I think everybody understands the importance of not burning bridges, of, again, if your mandate is truly to serve the people and to do what's best for the country, you know, you would think that you would have to put ego aside, you would have to put differences aside, whether they're personal or political, and just push forward with, mm-hmm. with your goals and your agenda, because if you truly believe that's the best thing to do for the country, then do it. And you know, we've seen that from some of these people. You know, we were talking about Mr. Bush before. That's exactly what Mr. Bush did. It could not have been easy for him to walk away not only from the government, but walk away from Mr. Eubanks and Mr. Bush, who had been longtime political allies and I would assume also personal friends. Mm-hmm. They live in the same, you know, neighborhoods, you know, the same people, et cetera. So that had to have been incredibly difficult. And I'm not saying, you know, that I'm not saying anything more than what Mr. Bush did there, or at least that what I took away from it, was he followed his beliefs, mm-hmm. right? And that's, you know, that's probably what that is in reference to, is, mm-hmm. listen, if this is what's best for the country and this is the direction we're heading, whoever's on board, get on the boat as long as you're rowing in the same direction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Another interesting dimension to this makeup of 10 people.
I'm really
glad you put those three women on the top there.
It really doesn't want to let me do it. I don't know why.
It doesn't want to let you.
It's
fighting against
today.
The
it
way.
Is. It
but
is.
Heather Bodden, Catherine Eubanks Wilkes, and Sabrina Turner, all newly successful in their seats. Three women. We saw, obviously, you know, in this campaign, there were only 11 out of the 50 candidates. But a number successful last night. These three potential members or members of the next government. Of course, Juliana O'Connor Connolly also winning her seat and Barbara Connolly winning hers as well. So actually, five women successful out of 11 running. The conversion rate there is pretty good, although, you know, we've seen in the election campaign some calls for or some criticism of the fact, not criticism, some observation that 11 running out of 50 was a disheartening number. These three women are now going to have a significant role to play in the next government.
Yeah, they will. And, you know, I'm curious on a couple fronts, you know, what this means for the Community Creates Country movement, and we can't call them a party because they're not a registered mm-hmm. political party, but certainly I think it's fair to call them an alliance or a team or whatever you want to say. And now that they were able to form a government with all these independents, you wonder whether, you know, what that might mean in terms of future collaboration. Will this government, you know, solidify into a proper formal political party and registered themselves as such? Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. I just right now wouldn't assume that would be the case, because they're probably all feeling that the reason they won is they were running as independents mm-hmm. who were able to rally against the government, and obviously their message hit home with enough people.
It is quite astonishing. It's something we remarked upon yesterday. When we look at countries, and there aren't many that have handled the COVID-19 pandemic well. And we talk often about New Zealand as the sort of, you know, the pinnacle of a country that really, really sort of held up well during the pandemic. And of course, the Cayman Islands doing well as well. In New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern, the Prime Minister, was returned to her seat based on having handled the pandemic mm-hmm. well, with a resounding victory. It was a very comprehensive success for her. We're not seeing that dynamic pay off. Perhaps I should say that, looking at the makeup of the next government.
Yeah.
Of course, you know, Mr. McLaughlin did win his seat. Many of the progressives, seven of them, in fact, were successful. People voting perhaps in favour of their handling of the crisis. We've certainly been kept safe as a jurisdiction. But now we're left with 10 totally different candidates. It's a fascinating way that the electoral system works.
Well, listen, the progressives, and I know this because Compass Media had been hired to live stream many of their rallies, and so we were present there and we were listening to what they said. Throughout this campaign, they were really hitting home the fact that we have kept you safe. Mm-hmm. We are one of the few jurisdictions on this earth where you and I can be having this discussion without a mask, mm-hmm. That, you know, we can go outside, we're not on lockdown. So that message was not lost on the progressives. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, if it wasn't the main issue that they were running on, it was certainly in the top three. Mm-hmm. You couldn't go to a meeting without them. You couldn't go to a meeting and you couldn't even hear one of the speakers at that meeting speak without talking about the fabulous job that the government has done handling the COVID-19 pandemic. And the thing is this, I don't know that was lost on the electorate, because
they did vote to return many of them to their
seats. Progressives members mm-hmm. that were part of the government got in, mm-hmm. right? The progressives members that were part of the government got in. It was Austin Harris who didn't, who's an independent, mm-hmm. and just quickly rattling around the others as well.
Well, Mr. McLaughlin was successful.
Mr. McLaughlin was successful.
Roy McTaggart.
Right.
David White was returned.
Right.
Connolly
was returned. So, you know, I don't know that just because they were able to form a government, I don't know that we can say that pitch from the progressives was unsuccessful, because in many ways it was. And Duane Seymour, he's not a progressives member, but he was an alliance member and the health minister. Right. So I don't know that we can say that, you know, the handling of the COVID-19 pandemic played a role in this, because many of those members were reelected. Mm-hmm. I really think it comes down to maybe who was ready to act quickly, mm-hmm. who was on the phone first, mm-hmm. who was able to offer the better deal, I guess, in the horse trading, who was able to, you know, maybe align the elected members' beliefs and expertise to a potential ministry. It very well could have been that several of the people who are making up this new government we're ready to jump on board with the progressives government. That very well could be the case. We don't know. But then maybe they got a call at 2 in the morning saying, hey, I know you're thinking about this. I know they've been in touch with you. But let's do this now. And you will be responsible for this if we're able to pull this off. And we are going to act like this. We will run our team like this. And obviously they liked what they heard, or we wouldn't be having this discussion right now.
Yeah, that's right. I noticed just here we are missing one. We're missing Isaac Rankin.
Oh, I feel like he's around here somewhere.
I was just counting up my numbers. 10, of course, independent members who were successful in their seats, who will form the next government, and Mr. Lindsay over there, not successful, but is the speaker designate. Talking about the COVID-19 pandemic,
I'm going to figure this out.
You figure it out, and I'm going to pose my next question to
sure.
you. It's very much something that people are going to be looking to this next government. We've been talking about the next steps, about border reopening, you know, people really beginning to feel the crunch in terms of those that work in the tourism sector, people whose businesses have been hurting since the borders closed last March. We're going to be now looking to these 10 individuals to really move us forward. How quickly will they unlock the economy? Will they adopt the same policy as the current administration have, or the outgoing administration adopted, which was that very cautious, very safety-minded approach? Preservation of life, of course, was constantly the refrain from the Premier during those press conferences, that was their most important factor when they were deciding what to do next. Interestingly, when we saw the independents campaigning on the trail, many of them didn't say that they would have done anything any different.
Well, that's what I was just about to say. I wouldn't expect, and we were having this discussion earlier today about, you know, oh, we were just hypothesizing, having some fun. Oh, what if a new government comes in and just completely changes everything? What if they just reopen the borders tomorrow and no more quarantine and whatever? And I don't, in reality, expect that to happen, partly because you hit the nail on the head. Just about everybody at their community meetings, if they were going to give some credit to the government, begrudgingly, possibly, but they had to anyway, or wanted to anyway, it was that everybody appeared to be satisfied with the way that the government had held the COVID-19 pandemic. I mean, voters might have felt differently. I mean, I did see a couple comments on social media about, well, anybody could have handled it like this. All you have to do is listen to the medical experts, and, you know, it doesn't matter who's in there. And I know the progressives heard that as well, because they brought that up at some of their community meetings. And so, you know, there might be some people who feel it to be easy, but I didn't hear anybody say they would have done the exact opposite. You know, there might be calls from certain corners of people saying we need to open up quicker, or we need to reduce the time in quarantine, or we need to do X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. But I haven't heard anybody say we need to do the exact opposite of what the former government did in terms of handling the pandemic.
Yeah, that's right. Often the criticism was more, you know, they did what they were told. They listened to the medical experts, as you say. And also people paying a huge amount of tribute and giving a huge amount of respect to the ordinary people who, when they were told these sorts of things that sounded quite draconian at the time, to stay home, to stay locked down for days at an end, at the very beginning of the crisis, of course, you know, largely people complied. People
yeah.
were willing to do as they were told, as they were instructed to do by the government, and it paid off.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, in terms of continuity on that front, I don't know that we'll see anything drastically different. And again, please listen to my words. I mean, I don't know, but I wouldn't expect them to, mm-hmm. right? Put it this way, the government may be changing, but the virus is not changing. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not true, too. The virus actually is changing, which is why it's so important, you know, to go get vaccinated and, you know, for us to, you know, maintain our level of safety here in the Cayman Islands. But you know what I mean. I don't mm-hmm. think that things are drastically going to change overnight on that front.
Mm-hmm. Although, of course, they will be under a great deal of renewed pressure from tourism leaders and other business owners who've felt, you know, they've been quite vocal in their call that we need a concrete plan. We need
yeah.
to put a date on this and start looking forward to this next phase.
Yeah, and that's where I would, you know, that's where I would give Premier Alden McLaughlin some credit, especially in the early days of this pandemic. You know, we were there for every single press conference, either in person or watching from home. And we heard the calls from certain sectors of, you know, the cure is worse than the disease. We're doing the wrong thing here. We need to open up quicker, X, Y, and Z. And he remained steadfast in his belief that what he and his government were doing was the correct thing to do. And I think that's where, if the progressives can kind of hang their hat on something, and if the premier can kind of hang his hat on something, yeah, it might be easy to say all he had to do was listen to the medical advice. Fine. But he didn't give in to the very significant and, you know, increasingly significant pressure from the business community, from tourism leaders, from, you know, Mr. McLaughlin had even made reference to people, visitors emailing him, mm-hmm. saying, I want to come, mm-hmm. let me in, you know, and I will give him credit for that, is they had made a decision, they were rowing their boat in that direction, and they stayed the course. Mm-hmm. So I think the question would be, not necessarily whether any of these, you know, 10 people think that this is the right thing to do, it's how they'll handle that pressure.
And, of course, they'll be facing a number of other challenges as well, thinking towards the financial services industry. You know, Cayman has encountered a number of challenges in that arena. The Financial Action Task Force, of course, greylisting Cayman, various issues with Cayman being blacklisted on EU tax lists and so on and so forth. I wonder, amongst these individuals, there's going to be a new Minister of Financial Services. I know in the rumour mongering, and we don't like to report on rumour mongering, we are seeing certain names, Mr. Ebanks, I'm thinking of in particular, they are being touted. Whoever it is, they're going to have a challenge on their hands.
Oh, absolutely. But that's what they signed up for. You know what I mean? This is, you know, yesterday was for the celebration. Today was for the negotiation. And then as of what, next Wednesday is the swearing in, right?
Yes.
It's your job now. And there's no more time to pat yourself on the back.
I thought you were going to give me another ION. Celebration, negotiation. I wanted a third.
I'm not that bright. we'll think of something.
We'll come up with something for you.
But, you know, they will be taking on their new role as legislators, and this is their job. It's no longer time to say, oh, I'm intimidated by the people in the financial services sector who want me to do this and that. It's all right. The people have elected you. It's day one. You know, get going. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it will be a challenge. There's several of those types of challenges and issues that Cayman is facing. You know, I don't. We can talk about those challenges, but at the end of the day, all 10 of these people. Well, I should say 9.
10.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh, yeah, sorry.
Mr. Lindsay's
throwing
me
off over here. All 10 of these people knew what they were signing up for. They ran spirited campaigns, spent a significant amount of money, I'm sure, to get to this point. And so if they weren't confident that they could do the job, they wouldn't do this. I mean, nobody does this just for giggles, you know what I mean? And so that might be the case, but they will be working, you know, with teams of people, with chief officers. They'll be getting advice from experts, and this is why, you know, we had talked before about some candidates, even about their opponents, were saying, even if I beat him, I still want to work with him because mm-hmm. he's smart mm-hmm. and he gives me good advice, and we've worked together really well before. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there'll be a lot of that going on. So, you know, nobody is working in isolation and in a silo. Isolation.
Oh, there
Got
we go.
It.
There we go.
Got it.
Celebration, negotiation,
isolation.
Not working in isolation.
Not working in isolation. I knew we'd get there. It's their time to meet the challenge. And if they don't, 4 years from now, you'll see potentially the exact opposite happen. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's really interesting because we're not only talking about there's a lot on the line for these candidates and now these parliamentarians. There's a lot on the line for the progressives as a party, and there's a lot on the line for the party system in general. You know, you could extrapolate what happened today and say that not the voters necessarily, but that the elected members are sick of what has been happening with the party system, and they've taken it upon themselves to make sure that doesn't happen again. And they actually did it this mm-hmm. year versus 2017. Should this not work out the way that they want it to, and I think we should explore that idea a little bit, come 2025, it's very possible that we would see, you know, a majority of, you know, a party, I'm guessing, the progressives at that point back in. So there's a lot on the line over the next 4 years for Cayman's political landscape on a you know, very high level, as well as the candidates themselves. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we had discussed earlier today was, okay, this is all fine and good. They've done this now. What is going to happen in 6 months? What's going to happen in a year? What's going to happen in 2 years? Are they going to be able to get along? Are they going to be able to continue having a shared vision? Because, again, we weren't on the phone. I wasn't. I don't know about you. So I have no clue what Mr. Pampton's conversations were with any of these people. But it's possible that it could have been, let's just not let these guys in again.
Yeah.
And that is not going to deliver effective legislation. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, that's what the people want. No, mm-hmm. That's what the people deserve. Mm-hmm. Effective and smart legislation mm-hmm. that makes the lives of you and I and everybody better. Mm-hmm. After yesterday and after today, I don't think people really care so much about whether you're an independent or a progressive or this or that. Are you representing me and doing what's best for me and my family that lives here?
And are you able to get things done?
And are you able to get things done? Exactly. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot on the line. They need to get things done, or I'm not so sure that we see a similar, and they need to stay together, or I'm not sure that we see the sort of arrangement again.
I think if we're talking about challenges, keeping the sort of group together, the unity issue, I think is going to be key here as the sort of years, possibly weeks, months roll on. When you have a coalition of independent candidates who haven't campaigned under the same umbrella, they're united now by this people-driven, accountable, competent and transparent pact that they're talking about. So far, that's the only indication we have of the policy or the umbrella under which they're united. It's a bit wishy-washy. Is it going to keep them together when they're disagreeing, when they have the challenges that the current administration have had, when they encounter controversial and high-spirited topics like the issue of domestic partnerships and so on? They have a controversy like the port. I mean, you know, something as divisive as that issue could potentially splinter a group that's made up of 10 disparate candidates that don't have that party machinery working behind them.
You know, I think that's a great point, Caroline, because there's two things to note here. People-driven, accountable, competent, and transparent all sound great and are all wonderful buzzwords, and we use them quite a bit in journalism as mm-hmm. well, especially with accountability and transparency. But what does that actually mean? You know, those aren't actual ideas. Mm-hmm. And of course you want to say you're going to be held accountable. Who's going to be elected and is like, you know what, thanks for voting me in.
Yeah.
You're not going to don't hold me accountable. I'm not interested in that part of the job. One thing I noticed, being a part of a lot of these crosstalk debates on Rooster in the Morning, and this is not meant to be a slight against anyone. I think this is just the way it is. Lots of ideas, not too many details on how we get there. Mm-hmm. And I think that is what, potentially for any government, not just this one, for any government, that could be the difference whether we're working well together or not. Yeah, okay, so we need to boost the economy. Mm-hmm. Everybody's going to say, "Yeah, we have to do that."
Mm-hmm. We need more schools.
We need more schools.
Better schools.
Our students need to be getting better grades. I need to be making more money. More people need to be able to buy houses. That sounds great. Mm-hmm. Less traffic. That sounds great. Mm-hmm. And there might even be some ideas on top of that. Ilios Alba, let's build the monorail. Mm-hmm. Great. Sounds great. And actually, I sort of do like that idea. But we were lacking details on how those things get paid for. You know, we were lacking ideas on whether we even have the supporting infrastructure to make some of these things a reality. Mm-hmm. Okay, we don't have to give concessions to a developer who's going to, you know, build something here. That's fine, you know. But then how does the government make up for, you know, if that developer doesn't build this here, how do they make up for the job losses? How do they make up for, you know, potentially the work permit income that they would have made on that?
The duties,
right? Mm-hmm. Because even though they might get concessions on certain things, you know, they might not get concessions on other things that they have to bring in. So, you know, that's really where I think the rubber is going to meet the road, is the details. And they have to agree on, yes, we all think that we should address cost of living. How do we do that? Mm-hmm. And then, okay, well, let's take this and put it over here. And that'll address cost of living. Okay, great. Well, what do we do with that hole that we've just created here in terms of income for the government, et cetera? Mm-hmm. So I think that's really where they have to make sure as lawmakers that they're all going to agree on how they achieve some of these goals. Otherwise, you know, it's possible that, you know, we'll see some splintering. I don't know.
I think you hit the nail on the head when you talked about how they're going to fund it. I mean, we're talking at the moment. We've weathered the pandemic largely okay because of the strengths of our financial services industry in this jurisdiction. And you know, the construction sector has been sort of touted as another pillar upon which we can rely. But, you know, hospitals aren't cheap. Schools aren't cheap. Roads are not cheap. You've got to make sure that those coffers are being replenished. And if you're taking money and investing it into education, for an example, and that is something that many of these candidates pinned as a top issue on the campaign trail, if you're going to invest a lot in education, where are you going to take that money from to pay for things?
I wish on the debates that we had given ourselves a little bit more wiggle room for follow-ups. And maybe, you know, in 2025, we just work it into the format where we ask a question and then every question gets a follow-up question of how are we going to pay for that?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's always the big one.
Of course.
Right? No matter what the topic is, you could take any topic and the question remains, how are you going to pay for that? And how are you going to make that a reality? So, you know, at the end of the day, I think people out there are probably relieved, for the most part, I shouldn't say everybody, are relieved that a government has been formed. I think that a lot of the independent candidates here, I think people are probably at the very least interested to see that they were able to form a government of independence. And possibly, you know, there are people who say this is the way it always should be. But at the end of the day, Alden McLaughlin is right when he campaigns on the platform of they are essentially 10 individuals who need to be able to come together and share, you know, share not only an idea, but a path forward on how to actually, you know, achieve that goal. And that will be, I think, you know, if it's popular to take a look back at the first 100 days. At the first 100 days, I think we need to take a look at what we're seeing in terms of are they aligned on how they achieve mm-hmm. that goal.
Interesting, Kevin, our reporter James Whitaker just sending us an update here, sending us a look at the manifesto that Mr. Panton and his running mate Heather Bodden campaigned upon under that umbrella of country meets community. One of the interesting things he does mention in the manifesto, and perhaps again another hint at what we're likely to see from this administration, environment. We know that's been a big issue on the campaign trail. We know lots of the younger voters that we spoke to really place green issues at the top of their voting priority list. Mr. Panton and Ms. Bodden on their manifesto list the environment. They state, we have a system that still does not recognize environmental issues as important to our success as a country and our well-being as citizens. Some people believe that the environment is disposable. They do not understand there is no real sustainable tourism product without a protected environment. We cannot label Cayman as successful without an environment that supports an enjoyable quality of life. A balanced, holistic approach across all government is needed to achieve this. And they list some of the ways that might be done. It's very small, so excuse me, squinting. Full implementation of the National Conservation Law, which gives the National Conservation Council the ability to make objective recommendations on the application of the Environmental Protection Fund. They list building a composting facility in each district, mandating that the National Conservation Council is properly appointed and active at all times to ensure balanced representation given as it relates to the environmental impact on new proposed developers. They want to develop and apply cross-ministry policies to address climate change resiliency, and they go on so on and so forth. Mandate that environmental studies is part of the school curriculum, expanding garbage collection services and prioritising the full implementation of the national energy policy. That's just some of the many things that they're listing on their manifesto and the environment. Of course, Mr. Panton, a former environment minister, if I remember correctly.
Finance, definitely. Or financial services.
Perhaps Mr. Bodden is who I've confused him with. Third member who wasn't successful in that community makes country alliance.
But I'd be lying if I didn't say that my head is swimming with names and numbers and Etc. So you could be right, Caroline.
Some of those other topics on that list are education, employment, economy, quality of life, healthcare, and the elderly, all things that they campaign
for. Do they go into as much detail on those other topics?
They do, but the font is really very small.
Okay, so. All right. No problem at all.
But our reporters will certainly be delving into those promises as we speak, and we'll be bringing you coverage about, you know, it'll be interesting to see how those inform their policies going forward, how they match up with the campaign promises that they made before they were elected.
Well, yeah, it definitely is. And I always go back to 2017 when we were working at Cayman 27 at the time and putting on the debates and working, you know, I think we put on a total of like 27 debates that year or something, 26 debates. And I couldn't tell you the number of times. I want to say every candidate at least once, if not more, talked about having the district councils. And here we are 4 years later, and we don't have district councils. And even in some of the electoral districts where we've seen, you know, informal councils being created, you know, that's great. But we have not seen kind of the formal district councils across the Cayman Islands as I think it was intended to be per the Constitution.
And that was something Catherine Ebanks-Wilkes in particular, she mentioned that on her crosstalk debate. She said it's one of the first things that she wants to achieve should she be successful, that the district council issue was something she was really passionately committed to. So again, perhaps a little indicator of what we're likely to see from her in particular in those first 100 days.
I wonder, too, you know, I'm just eager to see everybody in action. I think it'll be really interesting the first time that our reporters show up and, you know, just see where everybody's sitting. And it will be interesting to see some of the progressives sitting, you know, on the opposite side of the aisle. It's just, you know, we talk all the time about how Election Day yesterday was a historic day. And yesterday was truly a historic day on many fronts. But, you know, what happened yesterday and what happened today, whether we've been able to wrap our heads around it quite yet or not, really does, you know, guide the country forward and is a, it has the potential to be, you know, a monumental shift for the country, for better or worse. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't know. It's a wait and see on that front. But either way, it has happened. And I think what we're, you know, yesterday we witnessed history. And today we witnessed history today, just with the way and the speed with which mm-hmm. they were able to form this government.
And how quickly expectations and anticipated results can just turn on their head. It has been a very significant day.
I mean, this time yesterday, 24 hours ago, we didn't even have a single result in. And it wasn't until about 7:30 that we started getting the results. And then it was like a waterfall. Then they really started coming in. Which reminds me, kudos to the elections office. I think we said this many times yesterday, but just in case we didn't, they did a phenomenal job, you know, out in the field, but also in terms of getting the results through to the public and to us as well. They did a really great job there. So, yeah, you know, what we've seen today, Caroline, I think is a historic moment in Cayman's history. But like I said, yesterday was for celebrating. Today was for celebration, negotiation. And as of next week, no longer working in isolation.
That's going to be our catchphrase for the next 4 years, I think. It really is. I mean, this time yesterday, we really couldn't have predicted that we would be standing here 24 hours later with this particular makeup of the next administration.
No, and I'll take it a step further. I went home. So I got home at probably 2 a.m. yesterday or right about there. And as you do, went on Facebook. And I saw a Facebook friend of mine had posted something about, okay, here are the 10 independent members. If you all align together, I should say the independent members who were not part of the previous government, if you all align together, you still have the majority. Mm. So just because X amount of progressives were elected, and it seems like they could very easily and have a clear path to form a government, if you get it together, you guys could still make sure that doesn't happen. And I'll be honest with you, I read that and I was like, interesting idea, no way does that happen. You know, this is what I'm thinking to myself at 2 a.m. on the couch on my phone. And sure enough, that is exactly what happened. So I don't, you know, I got to ask that guy, you know, if he's a fortune teller or whatever, but there were people who said, that this can still happen, and sure enough, they pulled it off.
And Kevin, the twists and turns in this story, they're not over yet. We've just seen some more news coming into us. We've had a media release from the elections office confirming a complaint. The elections office confirms it's received a complaint 14th of April from a candidate concerning the handling of ballot boxes during the general election. Supervisor of Elections Wesley Howell notes that Section 51(4) of the Elections Act empowers returning officers to make provisions for the safe custody of ballot boxes, but does not specify how this process should take place. Mr. Howell is quoted, "We have always ensured that all mobile and postal ballot boxes are transported in sealed condition from a secure location to the respective counting station. This year, as an added precaution, we have used police escort when transporting mobile and postal ballot boxes. Furthermore, before the boxes are opened, candidates' agents are able to examine the boxes' seals for their signatures, which were placed there when the boxes were being sealed up and securely stored. As such, the process of transporting ballot boxes is both secure and in full compliance with the law." So the elections office there confirming that it has received a complaint. It's obviously early in the stage of investigating the merit of that complaint there, and that is in terms of the handling of ballot boxes. Mr. Howell stressing the process of the ballot boxes being transported, as it was done yesterday, was secure and in full compliance with the law. So the twists and turns in this story, they don't stop with this 180-degree turn, and there's going to certainly be more to come.
Well, and that's why elections are such big news, you know, and something that we'll continue covering here at the Compass, you know, throughout the coming days and weeks. It's good, and actually, I don't believe they named the candidate in this release, but I believe it is one of the government members who had lodged that complaint, if I'm not mistaken. But that's interesting. And again, you know, kudos to Mr. Howell and his team for the work they put in terms of preparation and execution yesterday, but then, you know, quickly following up here as well.
Is this the... thank you very much.
Thank you.
Breaking news coming into us. We have a statement from the Progressives. I think, in fact, she should come in. Because I'll move out and give you my microphone. Reshma Raghunath, our reporter here. Kevin, I'll let you introduce her.
Sure.
She's been running around. She's been covering this election like a maniac. Here you go.
I was a breath from running.
Correct. Yeah, no, I think maniac's a good way to describe it. Reshma, thanks so much for coming in. And Reshma was actually out at the fields trying to track down the government members for the last several hours. And like I said, we've been on the phone and messaging all day. Finally, we're able to kind of confirm this afternoon. So, Reshma, thanks so much for being here. And coming up, why don't you just read the release? We'll start there.
Okay, sure. Good afternoon, everyone. So, I am a little out of breath from running upstairs. Forgive me, but this is just in from the Progressives. It reads, "The election is over and the people have spoken. The Progressives Alliance secured 8 seats, and we have arrangements with Isaac Ranking, J.E. Banks, for them to help to form the government when they want."
Which is exactly what we were talking about last night,
mm-hmm.
and what we suspected.
And we were talking about that earlier today as well, right? We were running the numbers, who's been announced as part of the Progressives Alliance, mm-hmm. and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm continuing with the statement. "We recognize that Northside and East End have not been in government for 12 long years, and so we have offered a cabinet seat to Mr. Ranking. In addition, we also offered Ms. Sabrina Turner a cabinet seat. It is my belief, and it remains my belief, that by re-electing all of the current ministers, along with two of our parliamentary secretaries, that the country has voted for continuity of government. It appears that despite our efforts to outreach to those we wish to bring into government, that Mr. Wayne Panton has met with the governor and provided him with a letter signed overnight by 10 independent members claiming to have formed the government. However, over the course of today, we have been in discussions with several of the independents or their agents, and those discussions continue. We hope those discussions will bear fruit and produce an experienced and competent government capable of continuing to manage the complex issues confronting these islands. We will make a further announcement as soon as there are other developments, and may God bless these beloved islands." And this is a statement from the Progressives. So this is what it looks like.
So he's saying these conversations are... I want to go back to that part, but just because of the language, and I'm sure it was chosen very carefully. However, over the course of today, we have been in discussions with several of the independents or their agents, and those discussions continue. They don't necessarily specifically say what those discussions revolve around, just that they continue. We hope that these discussions will bear fruit and produce an experienced and competent government capable of continuing to manage the complex issues. What do you make of that?
I mean, I was there at the Progressives camp last night, mm-hmm. and both the Premier and Roy McTaggart, Progressives leader, their phones were going off almost simultaneously. In our interview last night, Mr. McTaggart told us that discussions are continuing. So we do know that over the course of the campaign, there were discussions that were happening, and on the final rally on Wednesday, on Tuesday night before the elections, the Premier announced names that he said that he had been in discussions with. Mr. Ebanks, Jay Ebanks, he announced Isaac Ranking. He even included Heather Bodden, mm-hmm. and off the top of my, I can't remember the other one, but he announced names. Isaac Ranking. So previously he had talked about East End, North Side candidates. He added Heather Bodden to the mix, Andre Ebanks mm-hmm. to the mix as well. So overnight we were hearing of discussions, secret meetings between the independents and discussions between the progressives as well. And the progressives were quite confident when they were talking last mm-hmm. night that they had this in the bag. So this morning we got information that actually, that's not the case. Mm-hmm. 10 independents signed an agreement overnight, and they are taking the government. Over the course of today, we, and all of us, the newsroom, we're having that discussion. Should we run with this? Should we wait? You know, what should we do? Mm-hmm. So what we did was the responsible thing. We tried to get the information verified and confirmed. And then I headed out to the government building to catch, hopefully, the government... the signatories of the governor, government, or the governor. Now, we waited in the hot sun, very hot sun, I will add, and Seaford and myself...
Get some water there if you need it.
Seaford and myself were waiting there, and the governor's driver, police escort, came down, he turned on the jag, and we were like, yes, okay, something's happening, he's coming down. And he did not come down for almost, half an hour out there in the blazing sun. And then he sends a message through, I'm sorry, Governor, but I do have to tell, you know. He sends a message through to us and said he's not going to be making a statement. And we did reach out to him directly and ask if he would be confirming a government has been formed, because we've been hearing the rumors all day. And he did respond and said, saying he can't say anything and he will make a comment when he is able to, which is fair enough. He can't say something that he doesn't know or he's not prepared to respond to just right. yet. So that's where we left it. We got him leaving government building. And then I get back to the office. We have the press release from the independents, Mr. Wayne Panton being named as the premier and the forming of a government. And within, an hour mm-hmm. or less, we get the progressives' statement. Now, we were hearing the concession statement is coming.
Well, that's why I asked about the language, because I don't know that that's what this is.
Oh, that is not a
right.
concession statement.
Right. Exactly. It doesn't appear to be so.
And to be honest, when I heard that a concession statement was coming, it took me by surprise, because I wouldn't have expected the progressives to give up that easily, or having stated that they had, they were moving towards forming a government, and then suddenly, without putting up a fight or working on those agreements that they in principle had with independents, for all intents and purposes, they did not run any opponents against these independents. You know what? It leads one to infer that they are not. You know, they were not putting up a fight against these individuals, so they worked into that mix that these agreements that they had, that they would come on board should they be elected. And that's reasonable to expect if that were the case. And then this entire scenario just brings me back to 2017, when we had that whole back and forth and the country was not going to have that turmoil again. That was the guarantee that we got last night, mm-hmm. that this agreement was in place, the progressives are going to move forward, and that's the end of it. And we're not going to have that instability that we had with announcement coming, walking back, coming again, mm-hmm. you know, so
right.
we didn't need that instability once again.
You know, and this is where we really need to call on somebody who can provide some historical context. Like, I wish, you know, Roy Bodden were here right now. I'd be curious to know if something like this, you know, has happened before, where we have a group of people claiming to have formed a government. The governor's office sent out a press release, not saying, and I should say this, all that the governor's press release says is that Mr. Panton presented the governor his letter confirming that he has the support of the majority of elected candidates who were successful in yesterday's general election and that he intends to form a new government. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that language was chosen
very
carefully as well. And so I guess what I'm trying to get at is, you know, is it possible? And I legitimately don't know. Please comment or write in or call if you know. Is it possible that in 2017, did the governor's office release a similar release when Mr. Bush had taken that photo with the independents and they had claimed to have formed a government? I don't remember that having taken place, but I don't remember a lot of stuff, so, you know, that happens. The other thing I'm wondering is if you're a progressive supporter or if you're a progressives member, what avenues do you have available to you to say, no, this is not happening? You know, I'm just curious to know.
And
I'm not even asking you.
A rhetorical question in a sense. But, I mean, just looking at the statement that you just touched on from the governor's office, I mean, the language does not say a government has been formed.
No, it does not.
It does not clearly say we have a government. He says that, just like you said, who was successful in yesterday's election to parliament and that he intends to form a new government. And just going back to 2017, you know, there were discussions, but I don't think, and the point was being made in the newsroom while we were all, you know, hashing this out, that back in 2017, the governor didn't get involved so early in the game, mm-hmm. that, you know, there were discussions, and then we had the announcement that there was an alliance formed with Makiva Bush and his two MPs, members of the Legislative Assembly at that point, MLAs. But in this case now, we have the announcement coming from Mr. Panton. And what makes me wonder as well is, why did the press release come from Mr. Panton's team first? Why not the governor's office? And then, I mean, I don't know. You know, these are things that inquiring minds would look at. Why didn't we have the official announcement come from the governor and followed up with it, or time together, or, you know, I'm just curious about it because I have a curious mind.
Yeah, well, you know, and again, it was 4 years ago, but I remember that there were several claims about, you know, we're working together now and we'll be able to form that government. And you know, we had brought up earlier the photo with Mr. Bush and the independent candidates, and they had claimed, you know, that was at like, I think it was like 2 a.m. or something that we got that message. They had claimed that they would be able to form a government. And then 2 days later or so, we found out that was not the case.
Mm-hmm.
And so you wonder, and I'm just going off on a bit of a tangent here, you wonder whether this is, whether somebody has potentially jumped the gun, whether candidates are very similar to what happened in 2017, mm-hmm. whether, you know, candidates might use this as an opportunity, you know, to leverage a more lofty position, possibly a ministry or something, or multiple ministries with the progressives. You know, mm-hmm. we don't know.
The flip side to that is, what if the release was issued to kind of seal in the deal so that no one, you know, can hedge their bets outside, because
right.
you are now being held to account that you've entered into an agreement.
Well, I think that's what, in 2017, I think that's what that photo was about,
mm-hmm.
right? The very unhappy photo with zero smiles,
mm-hmm.
Other than maybe one. I think that's what that was about, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
the so-called double cross hood around the world?
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Right? And, yeah, I mean, I guess that could potentially be a scenario, an option here. Yet we just don't know. You know, mm-hmm. what we know is we have the independents. We have one member of the independents who has sent us a letter saying that these 10 are going to form a government. Mm-hmm. We have the governor and the governor's office who has said that the governor's met with Mr. Panton and that he says they intend to form a government. Mm-hmm. We have the progressive.
He said they said.
Exactly. Right. One of those. We have the progressives who, again, their language is very broad, mm-hmm. But I'll read this. Despite our best efforts at outreach to those we wish to bring into government, Mr. Wayne Panton has met with the governor, provided him a letter signed by the 10 independents claiming to have formed the government. However, over the course of today, we've been in discussions with several of those independents, and those discussions continue. The discussions continue part is telling for me, because
yeah.
without, you know, if I'm able to read between the lines, that's them saying this isn't over. This is not a formed, this is not a sealed deal.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Just a minute ago, Progressives leader, Mr. Roy MacTaggart, and thanks, Steph, for keeping us up to date here. He just shared the statement that they issued, the Progressives issued. So just for those of you who want to follow along, it's there, and we will also be sharing it. James Whitaker is pounding away hard at the keys, and Michael Klein and Norma Connolly, you know, the entire team downstairs, Iris Stoner, just to get all this information out to you so you can follow along and keep track of the developments that are happening as we speak.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I'm glad we're having this discussion as well. Admittedly, when we first went on the air and the first statement that, and the only bit of actual information that we had was coming from the office of the premier designate, mm-hmm. Designate, which is Mr. Panton. That made it seem, and that was the only official information that we had at the time,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
that this was essentially in the bag, that this was decided, that we have these 10 members, mm-hmm. we will be forming the next government.
Mm-hmm.
And the progressives, whether this is legitimate or whether this is just, you know, a last-ditch effort to, mm-hmm. you know, keep their hopes alive.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. But the language they're using is not saying that.
And the panel made this point last night when you were going through the analysis, Tammy, Richard, and Mr. Roy Borden, that it's not over until the swearing in.
Right.
You know, and with a lot of the developments that are happening over the course of the next few hours, things can change again. I think Norma Connolly was the one who said it. Sorry, Norma. 20 hours is a long time in politics, you know. And with the way things are and the way things are shaping up, you know, who knows where we will be within the next hour. I mean, it's really tough for us to set a front page, right? We had the front page set earlier today. That had to be rejigged. And now I don't know what's happening downstairs. But, you know, we're going in for the long haul. I think we have some overtime that's going to be sorted out, Kevin, you know.
I don't discuss HR issues in public. So here's where we are. According to Mr. Panton, these 10, which is Mr. Panton, Andre Ebanks, Kenneth Bryan, Isaac Rankin, Chris Saunders, Bernie Bush, Jay Ebanks, Sabrina Turner, Heather Bodden, and Catherine Ebanks Wilkes, according to Mr. Panton, this is our next government for the Cayman Islands with Mr. Ulrich Lindsay serving as Speaker of the House. He keeps going back to this side. I don't know why. That is according to them. We have the progressives who are saying not so fast, without providing, you know, much additional detail, just saying discussions are ongoing. We have the premier. We have the governor's office confirming that the governor had met with Mr. Panton and confirming that Mr. Panton had told the governor that they intend to mm-hmm. form a government. That's where we are.
Yeah, and I mean, there's more news coming in as well, coming out of the election. The elections office actually this afternoon sent in a media statement indicating that it received and confirmed. Yeah,
yeah, we discussed that just
right,
a few moments ago.
Right, confirmed the complete.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And okay, well, I won't go there.
Yeah, we did not name the candidate.
Yeah,
who
okay.
The complaint.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Walking back.
So in terms of new information to report, mm-hmm. I think that is about it. I'm glad that we were able to stay on air this long because I'm glad that we were able to kind of provide a bit more perspective and context and perhaps soften our language even a bit, or I can only speak for myself, soften my language a bit as to whether this is a sure thing or not. You know, and we were talking about the concession from the progressives. Yeah, that's not a concession, right? That's a the fight is still ongoing.
And we expected as much, right? I mean, even though there's a signed deal, there will always be talks that, you know, there would be the possibility of walking back of agreements, because that's the nature of human beings. That's the nature of dealing with politics.
Yep. And you know, Caroline and I were discussing, too, if this government even is formed, you know, we're talking about 10 independents here, many of whom I would assume have not worked directly with one another before. You know, what is the possibility that there is, you know, splintering 6 months, a year and a half, 2 years down the line. And we got into all those discussions as well. But I think with that, unless we've got any more news coming in, as we've had some reporters enter the studio here, unless we've got anything new coming in, I'd say let's leave it there. I think we've offered plenty of A, news, and B, you know, we've skinned this cat several different ways. And so let's leave it there. But I would encourage you to pay attention to our YouTube page and our Cayman Compass Facebook page throughout the night. Should any new developments come up, anything significant, we'll go live and bring that to you. Head over to votecayman.ky. All of our, you know, election-related materials and reports are free, and we'll be monitoring the situation around the clock. Head over to caymancompass.com. If you subscribe to our newsletter, we'll have our updated information there as well. So many, many options for you and many ways for you to stay abreast of the situation. And like I said, we're not leaving and going home tonight and turning on the TV and not paying attention anymore. Our reporters and our editors will continue to monitor this situation and provide any updates and context as we can. I will say this, though, too, and this is a little bit easier, I guess, for me to conceptualize, seeing where the progressives are coming from. It makes a lot of sense that we haven't heard from any of these individuals yet.
Well, earlier today I got just a very brief statement from Isaac Ranking, and I can read it out to you just quickly if you want. And it's not much saying. Basically, MP-elect Isaac Ranking wishes to express a huge thank you to the District of East End, who has given him the opportunity to be their new member of Parliament. He has immediately begun working and will issue further updates and announcements in due course. And, of course, there are no other comments that will be issued at this time.
Sure.
So, you know, that's the only one we've actually heard from outside of the statement that was issued.
Yeah, and I mean, we had reporters on the ground there where, you know, these lawmakers or at least representatives for them had declined to give us comment. And that was just happening an hour ago or two hours ago. I had personally been on the phone with you know, a member of this government who had, again, provided some very valuable information, and I thank that person, but it was also noteworthy to me that they had declined comment. Mm-hmm. So, you know, again, I'm just kind of going off on a tangent there, but if you read between the lines, maybe they don't want to be too boisterous or, you know, come off.
Or show their hand either. I mean, there's still discussions going on, and they're sorry to cut you.
No, that's fine.
You know, and one of the things we might point out is Sabrina was a former progressives person on the ground, pretty much running the PPM red machine in Prospect Red Bay constituencies. Mm-hmm. So, you know,
Heather Bodden was a former progressive
as well. Andre, even though he wasn't a progressive, you know, he was part of the current administration and a very high level, you know, position as well. And I know you guys went through this already, so I don't want to rehash, but, you know, for just some food for thought.
Yeah. You know, because the only reason I even brought up the interview thing, and it, like I said, it's a little bit easier to kind of read between the lines now that we've seen what the progressives have put out. But I remember talking to Mr. Bush in 2017, or messaging with him, I should say, about the government that he had said he had formed with the independents. And if I remember correctly, you know, I think he was willing to give us some comments at the time. So all that to say, I was a little bit, you know, maybe surprised that, you know, this should be a joyous occasion for the 10 members who intend to form a government. And I was maybe a little bit surprised that they just weren't in a position to offer any further comment on the record, even something like, "This is really great," you know, not even something like that. So, it makes a little bit more sense now if, since we didn't get a concession from the progressives, we got a discussions are ongoing. Mm-hmm. And that does seem to, it would appear that that is the case. So.
Yeah.
All right. I think we're going to leave you there. Thanks so much for joining us. Like I said, we don't stop our coverage there. Pay attention, please, to our social media, to our Cayman Compass Facebook, to our Cayman Compass YouTube. Head over to votecayman.ky. Head over to caymancompass.com. We'll have up-to-date information there. And like I said, our reporters and our editors are on this. We live for this stuff. So we'll be updating this throughout the night and throughout the coming week or so. So, Rashma, thanks so much for your hard work today. Caroline, James, who joined me earlier in this live stream, want to thank her for her hard work. Seaford Russell Jr., who has somehow squeezed his way into the studio just to check things out. Thank him for his hard work, and we thank you for tuning in and watching. Have a great night, everybody.
Good night.